Good morning, everyone. It's good to be here in California. Had a lovely flight over from Minnesota. Not a bump. I'm used to bouncing over the mountains, but it was so nice to travel here and be with you all. If you'd open your Bibles, please, to the book of Revelation. As I was flying, I was thinking about these messages. Previously, in other conferences, I had to speak on the life of Peter in three messages, and then also on the life of the Apostle Paul. And then I was asked to do this on the book of Revelation. So how are we going to get all that done? Well, we're going to look at a panorama. And as I was flying, I was recognizing you're at 30,000 feet, but you don't realize you're going 600 miles an hour. Well, when we go through this, we're not going to be at 30,000 feet. We'll be at about 300 feet, but we'll still be going 600 miles an hour. So I would appreciate your prayers through the week and for all the brothers as we open God's Word. Let's turn then to Revelation chapter 1, and we'll begin by reading the first 8 verses together. The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show his servants things which must shortly take place. And he sent and signified it by his angel to his servant John, who bore witness to the word of God and to the testimony of Jesus Christ, to all things that he saw. Blessed is he who reads and those who hear the words of this prophecy and keep those things which are written in it, for the time is near. John, to the 7 churches which are in Asia, grace to you and peace from him who is and who was and who is to come, and from the 7 spirits who are before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead and the ruler over the kings of the earth, to him who loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood and has made us kings and priests to God and Father. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Behold, he is coming with clouds, and every eye will see him, even they who pierced him, and all the tribes of the earth will mourn because of him. Even so, amen. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, says the Lord, who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty. 100 years ago, a young preacher named Henry gave a series of messages on the book of Revelation, just a few miles down the road from here. It was at a place called the Gospel Auditorium at 42nd and Rich Street in Oakland. And those messages were put together in a very well-loved book today called Lectures on the Book of Revelation by Brother Henry Ironside. It was written in 1920. Yesterday, out of curiosity, I drove down there, and the building is still standing. It's quite worn, and I noticed there was a church that was still meeting there. I'm not sure if they still stand for the Word of God. I trust that they do. And I thought that was a wonderful picture of what we're doing this week in our theme, which is strengthening the things that remain. And so that charge that we've been giving, that's been echoing down through the centuries, here we are 100 years later after Brother Ironside, and we're doing the same thing, sharing these important truths in a day when they're needed. Now, it's very true that we find the book of Revelation very difficult. It's intimidating, because although we have some of our favorite verses, you know, there's more songs in the New Testament in the book of Revelation than anywhere else. There's more about worship, and we enjoy that. But when you get into the middle of the book, it gets very dark. It gets very difficult. And so because of that, no book has been more misunderstood and ignored than the book of Revelation. And so I just want to let you know, it's going to be a staggering message. It's going to be overwhelming, because it's supposed to be. When John was seeing these things, he fell down on his face 3 times. The whole host of heaven falls down. and all the stars from heaven fall from the sky. So if this book doesn't affect me to fall down and worship, then I haven't been reading it right. And if at the end of our time in Revelation, if we're not living differently, then I have misunderstood it. And so this is an important message. But you know what I've learned? It's very easy to get lost in Revelation. Back about June, I can tell you honestly, I was completely lost. I was like in a forest of trees, all these things I was gathering, and I couldn't find my way through the woods. But you know, when you're in a dark forest, you know what you need? You need a trail map. A map that's from up above, and it shows you you are here, and that it has a path to get through the woods. And so that's what we need in the book of Revelation as well. We need a good path. We need a good outline. And I have good news for you. I have the best outline ever on the book of Revelation. It's not mine. It's an inspired outline. It's the words of the Lord Jesus. Look at verse 19 with me. Verse 19 of chapter 1. Write the things which you have seen, and the things which are, and the things which will take place after this. I found if you don't know this verse, you cannot understand Revelation properly. And so look at that word things. That's going to be a key for us through this study. It will guide us through the forest. And this verse will be a key that unlocks the door through the book of Revelation. So it's a three-part outline. The first part, write the things which you've seen. That's Revelation chapter 1. And then the second part, and the things which are, that's Revelation chapters 2 and 3. And then number 3, and the things which will take place after this, and that's Revelation 4 through 22. And we just happen to have three messages to go through these chapters. But you can see it's going to get harder and harder, at least for me. So I've called this series a panorama of Revelation. I chose that word because part of it is in the New Testament. That second part, that orama, it's a Greek word that John heard. It says when he heard the call from Macedonia, he saw a vision, and that's the word there. And so a panorama is a vision, but the first part, pan, means all or one. So this is one big view of the book. And that's going to be a privilege for us to do. Oftentimes, I'm just focusing on a part of a verse or even a word or two in my studies. But here we get the opportunity to see the big picture. And that's what we all need. We need a Christian worldview to see what is happening in our world today through the lens of the Word of God. And so this will be a great opportunity for us. Interestingly, the author never tells us his name in his gospel. But here he gives it to us 5 different times. And he doesn't call himself John the Apostle or John the son of Zebedee. He just says John. It's obvious he was on a first-name basis with his readers. Of course John is the right one to write the final book of the Bible, the aged apostle who knows the Scripture. Because you know why? 270 out of the 404 verses in the book of Revelation are connected to the Old Testament. So here's another key. If you want to understand Revelation, you have to go to the Old Testament as well. And so you can see I'm marking all these little things with a key. That's my goal, to help us understand the book. And these are some tools that we can use. The date of the book is 96 AD, at the end of the Roman emperor's reign, Domitian. There's a number of reasons why we would know this, but also something I found interesting. The letters we're going to study this week were churches that were probably founded around 50 AD. And so that means almost 50 years have gone by, a couple generations. And so we've seen them grow, but we've also seen them start to struggle. Think back into your own assembly, maybe 20 years ago or 40 years ago. And the changes we see. The setting is also very interesting because it alternates between heaven and earth, and we go back and forth. And this is done to show us what the Lord Jesus Christ taught us to pray. Remember what he said, "Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven." And that prayer has not yet been answered completely, but it will in this book. But also the style of the book is most unique. And I was thinking of the best way to describe it. And here's what it works for me. It's like listening to a baseball game on the radio. And you're listening to the play-by-play announcer. As a young man, I grew up listening to the Minnesota Twins on my little transistor radio late at night. And although we weren't at the game, he would paint the picture with words of what was happening on the field. And then between the innings, he would give a little commentary on, here's what just happened. And then another time he might say, here's what you can look for in the rest of the game. And that's exactly what John is going to do, is he's going to use words to describe what he sees. He's going to paint the picture for us. And then he'll have these breaks called parentheses, where he'll stop the story and give us some other information, maybe something that already happened or something that's to come. And what's tricky is those parentheses aren't always in a chronological order, but his style helps us. And so understanding the book of Revelation requires that we interpret it right. And so we look at it with what I could call the plain interpretation. There's something called the golden rule of Bible interpretation. We all know it, but I think it's worth just repeating here. When the plain sense of Scripture makes common sense, seek no other sense, otherwise it results in nonsense. Now, that's true in any book of the Bible, but I think especially with the book of Revelation. So what this means is we take every word as we would ordinarily understand it in its plain or literal meaning, unless, of course, the text shows us that it's something different, like a figure of speech, a simile, a metaphor. So when you see the word "like" in the book of Revelation, that's a figure of speech. And so one of the reasons that we find Revelation so difficult, because it's filled with all kinds of symbols and signs. When you look at the book, it's almost like you're reading a different language, trying to figure it out. You have to learn sign language. What does this represent? What does this mean? And carefully discern those figures of speech. Now, we use those all the time, and it doesn't bother us at all. We say Fairhaven Chapel is hotter than an oven in here. And what do we mean? It's not as hot as an oven, but it's like one. And so the Bible uses those too. The Lord says he's the good shepherd. He's not a literal shepherd with a staff in his hand, but it helps us understand what he's like. And so it's so important for us to follow that important rule of interpretation. Because many people will read a symbol and they'll say, here's what I think that means. And I'm sure you've been in a Bible study where someone will say, this is what it sounds like to me. And you can see how we end up with so many different and often strange ideas from the book of Revelation. Well, maybe you're like me. I grew up hearing a lot of messages on the book of Revelation. And you remember the preacher would bring in the chart. We'd have it up for a couple weeks. As a kid, I loved it. I didn't understand it at all, but I liked looking at it. I remember one brother came, and when he got to Revelation 9, he talked about the locust rising up out of the abyss. And he said, those locusts are helicopters. And he used the words of the tail of a scorpion and the teeth of a lion and the crown of gold. But you see how we end up there? When we don't follow those rules of interpretation. So when we come to the book of Revelation, we can't just use our imagination. So what do? Well, I have a wonderful principle for you. The principle is that every symbol used in Revelation is explained or alluded to somewhere else in the Bible. You know who said that? Henry Ironside in that commentary I was just talking about. And so that's a simple rule for understanding biblical symbols. God is his own interpreter. Everyone's asking me, what's your favorite commentary on Revelation? It's the Word of God. He's the one who explains it for us. So it's not about what do I think it means. It's what else has God told us in his Word. Let me see if we can understand this a little bit better. Put these two words before you. On one side, the word symbol, and on the other side, a reality with a checkbox. You see, every symbol that's used is pointing to a reality. God is not trying to confuse us or use some secret language. He wants us to understand. And so another thing that's helpful is you don't explain a symbol with another symbol. That just gets you down a whole nother path. So how does this work? Well, right away in the book, we read of a symbol, the seven golden lampstands. So what are they? What's it picturing? What's the reality? Well, thankfully, the Lord tells us. He says the seven lampstands are the seven churches. So you see, it's not that hard when you just follow that rule. Now, that's the easy one because he gives it to us right away. But why are there so many symbols? Why not just say what it is? If I were to say, in the book of Revelation, we read of the Lion of the tribe of Judah. And I would ask us all, who is that? Every one of us would say, well, that's the Lord Jesus. And that's right. So why doesn't he just say Jesus? And then a few verses later, we read of a lamb. And again, I would say, who's that? And once again, we'd say, well, that's the Lord Jesus. So once again, why doesn't he just say the Lord Jesus? And the reason is because those symbols help describe his character. The lion is the king of the beasts. He's a conqueror. That tells us about the Lord Jesus. But what about a lamb who's gentle and mild? That's another description of the Lord Jesus, and we think of that sacrifice upon the cross. So there's a lot of symbols. Another part of that is there's a lot of numbers in the book of Revelation. Don't be afraid of numbers. They're a helpful pattern to follow. We all know about the number seven. The number of perfection and completion. It helps guide us through the book. But there's a lot of other numbers. The number 10, the number 12 is there 22 times. The number 4, but I want to pay special attention this morning to the number 3. That's going to help us. But then there's that other number. Everyone wants to know, what is that secret number? While back, my new license plate showed up in the mail. And I was studying the book of Revelation. Can you guess which number they gave me? There it is. 666. I was shocked. But I had to drive my car, so I put them on the car. Guess what? No one gave me any trouble on the road at all. I'm glad they expired and I got a new plate, though. So you see, there's all these different ways that are guides to help us understand the book of Revelation. But do you know the best way to understand the book of Revelation? It's the first 5 words of the letter. The revelation of Jesus Christ. That's all we need to know. You see, when the Lord Jesus was here on earth, he was veiled. He was covered. And what was that veil? The book of Hebrews tells us that was his flesh. And so a veil is a covering. And it was used to cover up his glory that could not be seen by man. So we know as well in the tabernacle there was a veil between the holy place and the most holy place. And that veil covered up the glory of God behind it. And although that veil kept us out, it also allowed us to be close to God. Because if the Lord Jesus wasn't veiled in flesh when he was here on earth, we would have been consumed. But you know what else that veil allowed him to do? It allowed him to sit with sinners. And he could explain to him the truth and who he was. Therefore, the Lord Jesus had to be veiled. He had to be covered. But it was God's plan all along to be able to remove that veil. And that's what the book of Revelation is all about. The unveiling, the uncovering of Jesus Christ. For that's simply what the word revelation means. To unveil, to uncover. And so the one who came here when his glory was veiled, now in this book, we're going to see him unveiled. And as John himself writes, we're going to see him as he is. We're going to see the Lord Jesus as he really is. But you know what? John didn't recognize him. This is not the Jesus he knew. This is not the man of Galilee, Jesus of Nazareth, that he saw every day. To see him as he is means to see him in all of his glory. And so that's our goal this week, that we might have a true vision of the risen, glorified Christ. And so I love how the book of Revelation begins, the revelation of Jesus Christ. So Revelation is a hard book to understand. But you know, it would make it a lot of easier if we spent our time just looking at the Lord Jesus instead of all the details of the end times. I found that most people are mostly interested in the spectacular things in Revelation. And everyone was asking me, who's the Antichrist? And you look at books in history and they've named all kinds of leaders in this world. You know what happens? Although it's interesting, it gets us off the message. It gets us off the point of it and what I'm supposed to do in response. So if we start looking for the Lord Jesus in this book, he will pull it all together. He's not hard to find. Because this book is a portrait gallery of the Lord Jesus Christ. So I'm an artist and I love to go to art museums. One of my favorite is the Smithsonian National Portrait Gallery. And when you go in there, you can see 10 portraits of George Washington, all in different settings, and you learn all different things about him. And that's what Revelation is like. In one room, there's a portrait of the Lion of the Tribe of Judah in the book of Revelation. But then there's another portrait of a lamb that was slain. And so the Lord is unveiled for who he is. But you know, this isn't the first time he's been unveiled. Remember, John himself was on the mount with Peter and James. And John writes this, "We beheld his glory. We saw it." And wouldn't that be a great thing if on Thursday when we leave and someone says, "How was conference?" And you just could say, "We beheld his glory." That's what the Lord wants. He wants that. And so what I want to do is just very quickly here, we're going to speed up to 600 miles an hour now, and show you how the number three works in this first chapter. Now, a music composer will use something called a triplet. And those are three notes in rapid succession, and they get your attention. And so the number three helps us understand a lot about our God. So let's look at a few. In the first verse, there are three recipients of the revelation. The revelation from God came to his son, who gave it to his angel, who gave it to his servants, to John and to us. Don't try to write these down. You'll never get it. And then there's three resources. In verse 2, John has three resources to write the book. The first is the Word of God. That's the Old Testament. And then there are the testimony of Jesus Christ. That's the New Testament. And then of the things which he saw, this vision he has of the future. And so John gives us his bibliography. Here's my resources. Here's my three witnesses. And how does the Bible establish a truth in the presence of two or three witnesses? And then in verse 3, we have a three-part blessing. Blessed is he who reads and those who hear the words of this prophecy and keep those things which are written in it. A three-part blessing. And you know what? There are seven blessings in the book of Revelation. The Lord knows we're going to get weary and we're going to get overwhelmed. And so he gives us these blessings through the book. And the first one is a wonderful blessing. So many people struggle with the book of Revelation. You know what the best thing to do? The first thing here is says, just read it. And so we're going to be blessed this week just by reading the Word of God and saying, what does it say? But then we don't stop there. We go on to hear it. We listen to it and we say, what does it mean? Help me to understand it. And we're going to hear this phrase over and over again. He that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says unto the churches. But we don't stop there. We go on to keep it, to preserve it. And this is what we should do. Instead of saying, I learned all these facts about Revelation, ask, what should I do in response? And this book is full of challenges for us to hear and to change. And then we come to verse 4. This sounds more like a traditional introduction to a letter. He gives us the author, John, the recipients to the seven churches, the location, who are in Asia, Asia Minor. And then that familiar greeting, grace and peace. And I stopped right there and said, wait a minute. Revelation? Grace and peace. A book of judgment and wrath. But you know what? Remember the blessing? If we look for Christ, what do we see? We see the one who is full of grace and who is our peace. Look for him. And it's written specifically to seven churches. The perfect number of what God is doing. And if you look in the book of Revelation 54 times, you'll read the number 7. All is a symbol of what God is doing. There's letters, spirits, lampstands, stars, and so forth, all with that number. And then it moves on from there, and we have a 3-part description of him. Grace and peace from him who is and who was and who is to come. He is in the present. He was in the past, and he is to come in the future. And so this talks about his past, his present, and his future. But it's not just that, because we all have a past and a present and his future and a future. In the words, they are in the continuing tense. He's not bound by time. Do you remember what the Lord Jesus said in John 8? John records it. He said, before Abraham was, I was. Is that what he said? He said, before Abraham was, I am. I am there in the past. I am there in the present. I am there in the future. He is eternal. So it's grace from him, God the Father, and from the seven spirits who are before his throne. Here's another stumbling block. Seven spirits, I thought we speak of the Holy Spirit. Well, that's where you have to get out of Revelation. You go to the Old Testament, to the book of Isaiah in chapter 11, and we have this sevenfold, manifold characteristic of the Spirit. The Spirit of the Lord, wisdom, understanding, counsel, might, knowledge, and fear of the Lord. And so you see, we have grace from him, the Father, and from the Spirit, and then in verse 5, and from Jesus Christ. So you see, together, that's the 3-part Godhead, the Trinity, all there in that verse. And then it talks about Christ, and we have this 3-part title. He's the faithful witness. That's his prophetic ministry. He's the firstborn of the dead. That's his priestly ministry. And then the prince of the kings of the earth. That's his kingly ministry. Prophet, priest, and king. And with that, he gives us 3 benefits. He loved us in the past. He washed us in the present. He's loosed us from our sins. And he made us kings and priests. In the future, we will reign with him, even though we're priests now. And so that's just the introduction. 7 sets of 3s. And then the book really begins. And he says in verse 7, behold, he is coming with clouds. I put that word in 200-point type, because that's how you read behold. You can't translate that into any other word. The word look doesn't cut it. Behold means you cannot miss this. You have to see this. And throughout the book of Revelation, John is keep saying us for us to behold. Behold, he's coming again with clouds. Remember when the Lord Jesus ascended back up into heaven in Acts chapter 1 and verse 8. He went up with clouds, but not many saw him then. But when he comes again, every eye will see him. And then we have 3 titles of the Lord Jesus in verse 8. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, says the Lord, who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty. Notice they're all eternal. I'm Alpha and Omega. I'm A to Z and everything in between. He says, I'm the beginning and the end. I'm the prophecy and I'm the fulfillment of the prophecy. But then he says, who is and was and who is to come? The Almighty. Now remember, back in verse 4, that was speaking of the Father. Now it's speaking of the Son. And he's telling us this wonderful truth of the deity of the Lord Jesus Christ. He's coming again. You know, for a book that has a lot of death and sorrow, I love how the Holy Spirit anticipates our emotion in this book. And he says, I can't wait to the end to tell you how it's going to turn out. And he puts it on the first page. He's coming. Put your eyes on him and keep them on him. Keep your eyes on the big picture, on the panorama. What a wonderful thing this is. And then in contrast, in verse 9, John says, hi, it's John, your brother. It's just me, John, your brother, your companion in tribulation. He doesn't say, I'm the apostle John, listen to me. He just simply says, I'm John, your brother. And I'm on the island that is called Patmos for the word of God and for the testimony of Jesus Christ. Why is John on the island? Is it a vacation? No. He's been exiled, probably by the Roman Emperor Domitian. Why has he been exiled? It says, for the word of God and for the testimony of Jesus Christ, for being faithful to proclaiming his word. But what's he doing there? You know what's interesting about Patmos? It's not far from Asia Minor. As the crow flies, it's only 60 miles to the city of Ephesus. But here he is on this island. He's thrown out of the empire. You know, although it might look attractive to us, it's a bleak place. In some spots, it's only 1,000 feet wide. He's there by himself. He's thrown out to the edge of the empire. But who does he meet outside the camp? The Lord Jesus Christ. And then he says this, I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day. And so he's there on the Lord's day, not the day of the Lord. That's later. This is the Lord's day, the first day of the week, Resurrection Sunday. And what's he doing? He's in the Spirit. So here's John. He's probably not able to be in fellowship with the other brothers to remember the Lord. He probably doesn't have a calendar, but somehow he's able to remember the Lord. He's in the Spirit. Now, what does that mean? Well, think of all the things we do when we gather in the Spirit. We pray in the Spirit. We worship in Spirit. We walk in the Spirit. We sing with the Spirit. And the Spirit of truth guides us through the sword of the Spirit. What a wonderful thing that he does. But then his worship meeting is interrupted, and he hears a trumpet, a loud voice. And he says this, and here's our verse now, verse 11. He says, this is the Lord, I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, and what you see, write in a book and send it to the seven churches which are in Asia, to Ephesus, to Smyrna, to Pergamos, to Thyatira, to Sardis, to Philadelphia, and to Laodicea. And maybe in the horizon, he can see that land 60 miles away. You know what's interesting? The Lord gives those in the exact geographical order there in Asia Minor, in a semicircle. But he says this, what you see, write in a book. So he sees something, but he's supposed to write it down. But not just to keep it that way, he says, send it to the seven churches. Now here's something interesting. When I would read this before, I would think he'd say, okay, here's the letter to Ephesus, let's send that one, and then here's the letter to the Laodiceans, and we'll send that. He says, what you see, write in a book. Now, a book wasn't pages, then it was a scroll. So he'd write that letter, and then he'd write the next one and roll it up and write the next one, and then the whole prophecy, the whole thing was sent to all the assemblies. And it's sent to us, too, to write it in a book. And he says this in verse 12, then I turned to see the voice that spoke with me, and having turned, I saw seven golden lampstands. What's the first thing he sees? These seven golden lampstands. What are they? Well, we saw the symbol. The Lord tells us the reality in verse 20. They are the seven churches. You see, that's not that hard. But the Lord knows we're weak, and he gives us a gimme right on page one. And then he wants us to work hard and dig hard to find the rest. So here's the picture. A church is a lamp. Isn't that a nice picture of your assembly? It's from you that the light of God is to shine out to this world. Why else do we have a lamp? It's not so we say, wow, what a nice lamp. When we have a lamp in our home, it's so others would see what's inside. And so when people come to our assembly, they often say, what a nice church you have. Wouldn't it be better if they just said, what a nice Savior that you have? So that's what we want. We don't want to illuminate ourselves. We are to shine. But you know, for a light to shine, it needs power. Now, our lamps here all need electricity. But of course, in those days, there was no electricity. What was used? It was oil. And in the Bible, oil is a picture of the Holy Spirit. And without that oil, there is no power at all in the assembly. We need His power. And then in verse 13, it says, in the midst of the seven lampstands, one like the Son of Man. Now John all comes into focus, and in the middle is one like the Son of Man. The Lord Jesus in the middle. All the lamps centered around Him. But notice what He's called, the Son of Man. Wait a minute, this is the vision of the glorified Christ? The Son of Man? You know what's wonderful in heaven? He'll still be fully man and fully God. The Son of Man. But why does He use that title? John knows, because John recorded it in his gospel. In John 5:27, and this is God has given Him authority to execute judgment also because He is the Son of Man. So here's the key to Revelation. The Son of Man is connected to judgment. He's the right one to judge. He's the perfect man. And so now we're going to see through the book that judgment will come. But you say, wait a minute, I'm here to study Revelation 2 and 3, the church. Haven't we escaped judgment? Hasn't the Lord paid for us? So we don't have to be judged. But listen to what Peter tells us in 1 Peter 4:17. The time has come for judgment to begin at the house of God. And if it begins with us first, what will be the end of those who do not obey the gospel of God? We're not judged for eternity, but the Lord is going to come and diagnose the assembly and give them what they need to do and let us know what we have to change. And then after this, here's the vision. Let me just read the verses so you can see what he sees in verse 13. In the midst of the seven lampstands, one like the Son of Man, clothed with a garment down to the feet, and girded about the chest with a golden band. His head and hair were white like wool, as white as snow, and his eyes like a flame of fire. His feet were like fine brass, as if refined in a furnace, and his voice as the sound of many waters. He had in his right hand seven stars, and out of his mouth went a sharp two-edged sword, and his countenance was like the sun shining in its strength. This is the unveiled Christ standing before him. Now, here's what's interesting. That full-length portrait we just read is going to be repeated in chapters 2 and 3 to the letters to the churches. And every little section of that will be pulled out and assigned to each one of the letters. And so our brothers will be expounding that particular quality of the Lord Jesus as it relates to that assembly. And what do we see here? Let me just give you a summary of what I see. It's purity and power. The holiness of God and the power of God. He's in this garment, this garment down to the feet and a golden band around his chest. It looks like the garment of a priest. But I thought he was a judge. Well, he's a priestly judge. He's the righteous, pure judge. And then his hair is white like wool. And you jump over to Daniel 7, and it speaks of the Ancient of Days with his head was like pure wool on his hair. His hair was like pure wool, white as snow in his garment. His purity, his wisdom is seen. His feet are like brass, speaking of judgment. And then it moves to the power. It says his voice like the sound of many waters. I think Ezekiel brings us that same expression, the power of his voice. And then seven stars in his hand, in God's right hand. Notice that. That's going to be important this week. The seven stars under his control, and out of his mouth the sharp two-edged sword. Our brother will unfold that, the word of God. But then this last one I especially enjoyed. His countenance was like the sun shining in its strength. You know, when Peter, James, and John were at the mount for the transfiguration, it says this. Here's their description. His face did shine as the sun. When Saul on the road to Damascus met the glorified Lord and he fell on the road, it says, a light brighter than the sun. And here John as well, the sun was shining in its strength. And in each one of those scenes, the reaction of those three groups is identical. And John shows us what that is in verse 17. When I saw him, I fell at his feet as dead. They all fall down. Saul fell down. Peter, James, and John fell down. And you know what? This is a different Jesus that John was used to seeing. This is the John who put his head on the breast of the Lord Jesus. And now he's at the feet of the Lord Jesus. But the Lord speaks, and what does he say? You better obey me now. What does he say? Don't be afraid. Remember the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ? Do not fear. He said this, I am he who lives and was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. There he is again. He's eternal. He's eternal. And then we come to our three-part outline in verse 19, and he ends this way in verse 20. Here's his commentary. This is the Lord's commentary in what he's seen. He said, the mystery of the seven stars, which you saw in my right hand, and the seven golden lampstands, the seven stars are the angels of the seven churches, and the seven lampstands which you saw are the seven churches. He explains it. So we get it. The seven lampstands are the seven churches. We say, yeah, that makes sense. The church is a light. But then what about the seven stars, which are the seven angels of the churches? Now that's the hard one. I spent a month just studying that expression. I had to write a whole paper on it. Thankfully, two of the brothers have that expression in their messages, so I'll let them explain it. It's hard to conclude, but let me show you something that I really enjoyed. When do you see a lamp? When is it useful? When it's dark. When do you see the stars? When it's dark. This is a nighttime scene. The lamp is there shining on earth, but the stars are in heaven. And each one of these letters is written to the angel of the church. It's not just a messenger, because that angel is responsible for all the troubles that are in the church as well. And so there's this idea maybe of a representation before God in the spiritual aspect. But then in closing, there's also three applications of this letter. And we're going to look at this tomorrow. These seven letters, we can apply them in different ways. The first way I call timely truth. Timely truth. These are real churches in Asia at the end of the first century. You can go visit them or their ruins today. You can see these cities. And so the Lord knew what they needed. He gave the diagnosis, and it was timely truth. But then secondly, you can also use these letters as timeless truth. And these letters apply to any church at any time, anywhere. And so you read something in the letter to the Ephesus, to the Christians at Ephesus, and you say, that sounds like our assembly. So it is timeless truth. But then thirdly, it's also a timeline of truth. And in these seven letters, you have a prophetic history of the church from Pentecost to the rapture, in order from Ephesus down to Laodicea. And we'll spend some time tomorrow looking at that. But what should we do? And I go back to that blessing, that three-part blessing. We should read it. Behold him. Look at Christ. We should hear it. Listen to him. Hear what the Spirit says unto the churches. And then we should keep it. What did John do? He bowed down and he honored him. And so that's the panorama of Revelation, part one. Let's pray. Our Father, we thank you for this truth. Lord, it is difficult. But Lord, we thank you that if we dig, you have wonderful things for us to learn, especially about the Lord Jesus. We ask your guidance in the next message and throughout all the messages in our time of fellowship this week. In Jesus' name, amen.